One day, I get a call from Sergio Pinafrina. When I come over to Turin right away, it was important. Boom, I fly to Turin. He says, Malcolm, I hate to tell you this, but you got 6 months more selling our car. I'm selling 1,000 a month, by the way, making a couple $1 million a month. And at the end of 6 months, I can't sell you any more cars. Excuse me. You're selling more cars than you ever sold in your life. Is there something you don't like? Oh, no, no, you're doing a great job. But I just made a deal with the Cadillac Elante to build and design the Elante over here, build the body over here, put them on 747s, fly them to Detroit, where they're going to put the motors in, the transmissions in, and sell it for $55,000 with my name on the side. And they don't want me to be selling in the United States a $12,000 to $15,000 Pininfarina. And I know I can't cancel you because that's against the law, but I can stop production because that's part of the contract. And I'm sorry, but this is more important than your business. Oh, shit. I can't just sell one. This is not an, I mean, selling a couple a month each. This is not a dealer doesn't want to have it if he can't have them both. Crap. Now what am I going to do? I get Tony Simonera. I said, Tony, I got 6 months. We got an organization. We got everything coming in and we got money. You go around the world and find me the goddamn cheapest car in the universe. He comes back with, I found it. This Yugoslavian car, Yugoslavia, where in the hell is Yugoslavia? And aren't they communist? Yep, yep, partly, yep. Mm-hmm. And one thing one led to another, and I decided we were going to sell 3990 cars and send my people over there. And in 14 months, met with 535 changes. We met every regulation, safety, and admissions, and never had a recall. The only car never had a recall. It was a... The handles would fall off. We'd have to put them back under warranty. We had a 3-year warranty. We took care of everything. So it was sloppy kind of assembly, but safety-wise and everything else, we never had a problem. And sold them as fast as we could bring them in. It was the hottest goddamn car. Some people, some dealers were making $3,000 over list on a $3,900 car.
And no consumer report damage?
No, they didn't give me, I don't think so. If they did, it didn't hurt me, no. I don't think so. Because we had to meet the regulations by law. So even though it was a little car, they had nothing they could make a story about. The other one was I found a way to evade the law.
Okay, but I thought you said you made your 500 and change changes to it. So you got through pollution and safety.
And I made it nice. We put nicer seats. We had to put seat belts in there. We put PPG over there to teach them how to paint metallic paints. We paved the ports. We had to bring in athletic gas. We had to take the rust off the railways that took it from there to the ports. We had to get shipping. We had a few things to do in 14 months. We had to set up 400 dealers. We had to bring in parts. We had to do trainings. You know, and we did them all. What happened was, we were selling cars as fast as we come in, and I was making millions a month. This was a great little story, all right? It doesn't matter about all the minor stuff. Then somebody came to me, because I was now looking at other countries to find other cars so that our dealer would have cars from a lot of countries in case I had a problem with one of them. And I remember, I was a little scary about politics, and this is a country. I mean, we were it in that country. Somebody came to me and offered me money, $20 million to sell out. And I said, I wasn't interested. Now, I have to give you some information. There was a day before the contract was signed that I was flying into Belgrade, which meant you fly into Zurich and you waited for another plane to take you to Belgrade. I was in the Zurich VIP room taking a leak, and taking a leak next to me was Henry Kissinger. I say, Henry. Well, we're taking a leak, by the way. Henry, yes. Said, I understand that Larry Eagleburger is working for you as your president. Yes. Wasn't he Yugoslavia's most favorite son when he was ambassador to Yugoslavia? Yes. Well, I'm going to be bringing in a car from Yugoslavia. We should probably talk. Yes. And while we're taking a leak, he hands me a card over the petition. I put the card in my pocket. Go off to Yugoslavia. When I get back, I have a call already at the office from Henry Kissinger, which surprised the shit out of me. Why would he give a fuck? Calls me up. He says, we're interested in talking. So I go over to his office at Park Avenue. Eagleburger is there. Tell him what I want. I want him to be on the board. I want him to be a director. I want him to be on the board. I want him to help us make them feel comfortable, basically. So he says, well, Larry, Larry will be your board of directors, and you'll pay us $250,000 to be consultants, and we'll help you with whatever you need. Now, I later realized this is the country that was imploding. I didn't know it was imploding. And he probably checked with his political whatever before dealing with us and found out it would really be good since we're the major thing that was happening in Yugoslavia. And that what they were really looking at is for us to be successful, because our success might have kept the country together. I didn't know all that. So I got Larry Eagleburger there. I get a call from Larry one day. Malcolm, we got to go to Yugoslavia and meet the new president. Okay, no problem. I mean, I would go there once a month anyhow. So we get on a plane. Now, Larry was a big guy. Larry was a heavy smoker. Larry needed one of those. Now, here's a smart man that became our Secretary of State after Hugo, by the way. And he's smoking cigarettes and using the pump at the same time. And that's what he died from. So we go to Yugoslavia, and we're going to meet Mr. Slobovevich and his wife, who became the new president. And we meet in a beautiful, ornate room. And of course, everybody is kissing our ass like crazy. We are what is happening, period, in Yugoslavia. When I went to them first, the only country they sold a car to was Russia on barter. Once Yugomania took effect from the United States, they were selling to 70 different countries. They were high on the hog. So Mr. Samosevich and his wife were being extremely nice to me and Larry. And after about an hour and a half of cocktails and bullshit, and we left, and I turned to Larry and I said, I'm selling the company. He said, what's your problem? I said, Larry, I can't explain this. I have never been in a room where I felt evil. My hair, when I talk, it's there. My hair is standing up. They're nice people, but they scare the living shit out of me. And I'm getting the hell out of here. He says, you're out of your mind. 1 month later, I sold off for $20 million to an investment firm that had a kid that thought he was smarter than me, and he was going to go be chairman of the board of this car company. And it doesn't matter. God bless him. And then they went off the races. The reason the company failed, if you'll remember, the United Nations put an embargo on Yugoslavia. You could not buy or sell anything from Yugoslavia. And then NATO put 5 missiles into the Zastava car factory. And that's why they stopped selling in the United States.
Malcolm, I've enjoyed every minute with you. This is one of the most fun. You talk about loving something. I don't know if this will ever turn into money or not, these recorded conversations. But as far as juice in life, value of life, this is like getting to hear the greatest stories in the world if I didn't know who you are, but on top of being such a giant figure in my life and so many people's life, I really appreciate it.
Well, you say such nice things, I can't help but want to come back.
This has been Jeff Stearns, Connected Through Cars.